Hello students, welcome to the class on answer writing, and in this class I will be dealing with the questions that I have uploaded on brainyki.com on 2nd of November. So the first question was, critically analyze the legal checks for political vandalism in India. Now what is political vandalism? Political vandalism is when the political parties, they resort to violence. When the political parties, they try to choose the path of intolerance and cause disturbance. Now in such a situation, the political parties should be held liable for the crimes. But in India, we don't have a law that in which we can put up a case against the institution, against a company or against a political party. Now the kind of the legal checks that we are having is like imposition of section 144 if there is a disturbance caused by the political parties. Now we have got n number of informal and formal groups, social groups, which are having associations with the political parties. Now these groups, they actually carry forward the agenda of the political parties, like the Narayan Senas, like the Ram Senas. These are working for the political parties like BJP and Shiv Sena. Now whenever they resort to a kind of vandalism, no action is taken against them. So section 144 proves to be quite superfluous. Secondly, we are having Representation of People's Act. Now under Representation of People's Act, we cannot declassify and deregister a political party. The Election Commission as an institution is quite weak. It only conducts the elections, it can only reprimand or censure the political parties, but it cannot impose big penalties, and moreover it cannot deregister and declassify the political parties. Now another thing that we are having is Prevention on Unlawful Activities. Now to call some political party as an unlawful performing party, it requires a lot of courage, needs to be mustered in order to do that, but that is generally not done. But what should be done if we want to stop this intolerance, if we want to stop this vandalism? There needs to be some kind of a legal setup. Legal standards should be there which the political parties should be bound to adhere. Only then we can stop this political vandalism, else the situation will become quite tough in a country like India, which is beset with n types of diversities. Diversities based on caste, color, religion and region. Then second question is, how the 14th Finance Commission has differed from the approach of its predecessor in granting the aid to the Panchayati Raj institutions. Now the change that has been introduced, 13th Finance Commission, it has come out with something really immaculate. Now what immaculate that was? Now under Indian Constitution we are having a federal setup, but in reality what we are having is three layers of the government, and the third layer of the government, that the local governments, they are dependent on the state governments for the resources and for the delegation of the function that are done to them. Abhi unko functions kya kya karne hai local government ko, ye kaun decide karta hai? State government. Paisa kitna dena hai, it is decided by the state government. Now kitna paisa dena hai, this was decided on the basis of the performance of the local governments, and this was the suggestion of the 13th Finance Commission, because generally there is no kind of enforcement on the recommendations of the state finance commissions. So the performance was acting as a kind of a pressure. Now this pressure has been removed. The 14th Finance Commission has not recommended this to be a criteria for granting the aid. And in such a scenario, the Panchayati Raj institutions, the local governments, they will be bereft of money. Without money, you cannot run administration. Finance is the basis of administration and governance. Now the third question is about decode the Somalian conflict in detail. Now, as far as Somalia as a country is concerned, it was ruled by President Sed Bere. Now, Sed Bere has introduced socialism in Somali in 1967. From 1967 onwards till 1990s, the situation was getting deteriorated. Why the situation was getting deteriorated? It was getting deteriorated because Somali had associated itself with USSR. And on the other hand, the Western forces, the capitalist forces, in the beginning they were trying to align with the countries which were having the boundary conflict with Somalia. In such a situation, the position, the legitimacy of Sed Bere declined and he had to be removed. He was removed from the post of president in the year 1991. After 1991, what we are seeing, the 14 governments have been formed till then. And the another thing about this Somalian crisis is that a terrorist outfit named Al-Shabaab has taken roots in Somalia. And because the government is very weak, there is a rise in the issue of piracy. Then sea piracy is existing there. Then apart from that, the western part of the Somali, it has formed a nation in itself, the nation of Somaliland. But the world has not recognized that nation. So it is a kind of a big problem which had resulted out of the conflict between socialism and capitalism, further fueled by Islamism, terrorism. Then next question is, explain about the Nigerian conflict and how and what is the world stand on it. Now Nigerian conflict, if you look at Nigeria as a country, it is on this western coast. Here it is Nigeria. Now Nigeria is actually divided into two halves, the northern part of the Nigeria and the southern part of the Nigeria. Now the southern part of the Nigeria, it is really developed in comparison to the northern part. Now why it is developed? It is developed because the Britishers, they were entrusted in the oil of Nigeria. It is full of oil. Now the oil, to get the oil, to extract the oil and to export it to England, they had developed this southern region because the ports were here. Now the northern part of the country, it has remained backward. There's a lot of illiteracy, there are a lot of superstitions, and entire Nigeria, it has got about 50 ethnicities, and the people residing in the north of the Nigeria, they're entrusted in institutionalizing Sharia law. Wo chahte hain ki yahan pe Sharia law lag jaye Nigeria mein. And this is something that has given the birth to Boko Haram. Now the West is not interested in the institutionalization of the Boko Haram's Sharia government because that will have an effect on their accessibility to the oil. So the world's response is again a biased response. We are having international bias set up, the biased response at the ground level. So the last question is about the WTO. Is multilateralism the solution to the dormancy of WTO? WTO is lying in dormancy, and dormancy of WTO has given rise to the multilateral economic forums. Various multilateral East Asian summit is there, then we have got ASEAN, then we have got European Union is one such. Then we have got BRICS. BRICS is less an economic institution but more a political institution. Then apart from that, we are having Trans-Pacific Partnership. Then we are having Trans-Atlantic Partnership and Investment Corporation. Then another kind of corporations are on the rise because the WTO is lying in the state of dormancy. In the state of dormancy, Doha Development Agenda has not been resolved properly. There is a division, there is a dichotomy between the stand of the developed world and the developing world. There are issues related to intellectual property rights. There are issues related to agriculture. There are issues related to the health of the poor countries. There are issues related to the service sector. There are issues related to the tax things. And all these things, it is very, very tough to make a uniform law for the entire global. because if you want to make a law, you need to provide a kind of equity and equality. Now, what the world wants is equity. They don't want equality. So, WTO is not offering equality. The nations are shifting to multilateralism. So, this was all for the day. Bye-bye. Take care. Have a nice day.